بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم طلبتنا الأعزاء، أتمنى تكونوا جميعاً بخير وسلامة، ونحب بالبداية نهنيكم بمناسبة عيد الفطر المبارك. الله يعيد عليكم وعلى عوائلكم إن شاء الله الكريمة بكل خير وسلامة وعافية، وتحقيق جميع أمانيكم بالنجاح الباهر إن شاء الله. Today our lecture is talking about thrombophilia, which is presented by me, Dr. Inas Abdelkarim, lecturer of Hematopathology, College of Medicine, University of Karbala. Thrombophilia, it is an important subject from its name, thrombophilia. Thrombo is derived from the word thrombosis. Thrombosis. Philia means this suffix, هذا المقطع, mean any increment, like neutrophilia means increase in the number of neutrophils, basophilia increase the numbers of the basophils. As examples, eosinophilia increase the number of eosinophil, and so on. So thrombophilia means increase the tendency for the thrombosis, increase tendency for the thrombosis. زيادة القابلية الخثرية للجسم, زيادة قابلية الجسم على التخثر للمريض طبعا. So thrombophilia as a definition are disorders of hemostasis detected in the laboratory that appear to predispose to thrombosis. So it is a disorder of hemostasis detected in the laboratory that appear to predispose to thrombosis. So I can't say thrombophilia without I have some document in the laboratory. I have documentation, laboratory tests that tell me that there is an evidence for thrombosis. Thrombophilia can be divided into heritable and acquired. Heritable and acquired. Regarding the pathogenesis in general, pathogenesis for thrombosis in general, we have what we call it verkhoserite, thulathiyat verkhos. Verkhos, it is the name of the scientist that discovered the pathogenesis for thrombosis. This scientist, هذا العالم, suggests that there are three components that are important in thrombus formation. Three components that are important in thrombus formation. What are they? They are slowing down of a blood flow. In another speech, we call it stasis of the blood. Stasis of blood. So, slowing down of blood flow. Second, hypercoagulability of the blood. And third, vessel wall damage. It is so important. بالمناسبة, I make starring for you in this lecture, starring this subject has a 3 stars, mean it is so important for you to know. تقريبا المحاضرة تراوحت بين 3 starring and 2 starring. So 3 starring means it's very important to know, and 2 star, it is nice to know. We divide previously thrombophilia into heritable and acquired. Also, according to the sites for thrombosis, it can be divided into either arterial, and if it is occur in the arteries, or venous, if it is occur in the vein. طبعا venous thrombosis, it is more common. It is more common than arterial thrombosis. So, this table speak about the risk factors for arterial thrombosis. Atherosclerosis. What they are the risk factor? What are the risk factor for arterial thrombosis? They are positive family history, male sex, hyperlipidemia, hypertension, diabetes mellitus, gout, polycythemia, which is a form of myeloproliferative disease, as you take it in the previous lectures, hyperhomocysteinemia, which is a big entity, hyperhomocysteinemia, which means there is increment in homocysteine, which is occur due to many causes, either genetic causes or even sometimes acquired causes like folate and B12 deficiency, thyroid diseases, another disease. So if homocysteine occur, increment occur, it may cause increased tendency for thrombus formation. Also cigarette smoking, ECG abnormalities, elevated C, the active protein, interleukin-6, fibrinogen, lipoprotein-associated phospholipase A2, lupus anticoagulant, كل هذه vascular disease بهجت disease C reactive protein C RB means here active protein ECG we mentioned it. So these are so important for you to know risk factor for arterial thrombosis. Let's come to the also this important subject inherited causes for thrombophilia. Previously we mentioned that thrombophilia is either heritable or acquired. First, let's mention inherited causes of thrombophilia. It is either hereditary deficiency, of coagulation factor inhibitor, protein C, protein S, and antithrombin deficiencies. You take in the lectures, previous lecture for hemostasis, normally we have a procoagulant factor, you know them. Also, we have natural anticoagulants. Natural anticoagulant, from them, they are protein C, protein S, antithrombin. So, any deficiencies of these inhibitor, أكيد من المتوقع عندنا procoagulant factor من اسمهم procoagulant factor أي زيادة متوقعة بيهم راح تسوي لنا increase the tendency for thrombosis. زين عندنا أيضا inhibitor اللي واجب الانهبيتر من اسمه إنه هو يثبط لنا الثرومبوسيس فأي نقصان بالانهبيتر أكيد راح يصير عندنا شنو من المتوقع إنه راح يصير عندنا زيادة بالقابلية الخطرية للجسم. لذلك الـ hereditary deficiencies of coagulation factor inhibitor اللي هي protein C, protein S, antithrombin deficiencies. What else? Hereditary disorder associated with increase in level or function of coagulation factor. قلنا احنا عندنا procoagulant factor او coagulation factor نصيح لها وعندنا anticoagulant. فالزيادة بالcoagulation factor راح will cause increase the tendency for thrombosis والنقصان in the coagulation factor inhibitor اللي هي protein C, protein S, antithrombin deficiencies these will cause also increased tendency for thrombosis. So hereditary deficiency, a disorder associated with increased level or function of coagulation factor. عندنا مصطلح مهم جدا وموضوع مهم اللي هو اسمه activated protein C resistance factor V lead, 5 leading اللي هو will be mentioned later on in details. Prothrombin 2210A mutation increase factor 8, factor 9, 7, 11 and dysfibrinogenemia. Hyperhomocysteinemia, we mentioned it previously. Defect in fibrinolytic pathway and altered platelet function. All these are inherited causes for thrombophilia. Should put in mind, and it is an important subject, and we will mention them in details later on in another slide. Let us go to them one by one and mention them in details. First of all, as we mentioned previously, antithrombin deficiency. What is antithrombin? Antithrombin is a glycoprotein serine protease inhibitor. Its gene, serine C1, is located on the long arm of chromosome 1. Targets. How antithrombin acts as anticoagulant? Its targets and function and acts on thrombin, factor 10 and factor 9. Activated factor 10 and activated factor 9. So, its targets are thrombin, factor 10 and factor 9. It's act to inhibit their function. That's why it's act as anticoagulant in such a manner. How many types of deficiencies antithrombin fall in? We have type 1 deficiency, which is characterized by quantitative reduction of antithrombin caused by several whole or partial gene deletion. Adna type 1, عادةً type 1 caused by quantitative إذن كمية نقصان الكمية للأنتيثرومبين واللي هي سببها أما whole or partial gene deletions حذف whole or partial gene deletions still in antithrombin deficiency, we have type 2 deficiency, which is due to the production of a qualitatively abnormal antithrombin protein due to numerous point mutation. إذن صار عندنا type 1 اللي هو السبب reduction in the amount of antithrombin, والtype 2 وسببها طبعا قلنا deletion, حذف in the gene of the antithrombin. Type 2 deficiency, it is due to production of a qualitatively abnormal, إذن المشكلة بالstructure مو مشكلة بالكمية, function and structure of antithrombin protein due to numerous point mutations. These are all I want you to enumerate them, not know them in detail, no need. Type 2 reactive site, type of, these are point mutations that occur in the antithrombin structure causing type 2 deficiency. This is type 2 reactive site, the mutation that occur in the reactive site for antithrombin, or it's occur in the heparin binding site, HBS. And third, it is what we call it pleiotropic, type 2 pleiotropic. Also, all these three types can occur in the antithrombin, causing point mutation and leading to type 2 deficiency, which is lead to the production of qualitatively abnormal antithrombin. So antithrombin deficiency, before we go to another subject, we have two types, either quantitative deficiency, which is type 1, occur due to whole or partial gene deletions, حذف, and type 2, it is occur due to qualitatively abnormal production of qualitatively abnormal antithrombin, and it occur due to many new point mutations, either in the reactive site of the antithrombin or heparin binding site of antithrombin, or what we call it pleiotropic type mutation. Another subject, it is protein C deficiency. We are still in the inherited causes for thrombophilia. First, we speak about antithrombin deficiency. Second, we speak about protein C deficiency, which is another type of natural anticoagulant in the body. Its deficiency can lead to increased tendency for thrombosis and thrombophilia. The gene for protein C, PROC, is located on chromosome 2. What is a protein C? It is a vitamin K dependent glycoprotein synthesized in the liver. How it is act? It is activated by thrombin bound to thrombomodulin on the endothelial surface. This is facilitated by the endothelial protein C receptor. I think this speech, it is just for memorization. You have to take it previously in the subject of hemostasis given to you. So just these for memorization. I think that you have to take it and know it. How it acts? It is acts as we know as anticoagulant through inhibition and cleaving the cofactors factor 5 and factor 8, activated factor 5 and activated factor 8. Also, as you know previously, that protein S, which is another anticoagulant, it is a cofactor for activated protein C mediated in activation of factor 5 and 8, act as a cofactor for the activated protein C mediated its inactivation and its inhibition of factor 5 and factor 8. Also, again, protein C deficiency, it is classified into type 1 and type 2 deficiency or defect. The same as antithrombin deficiency, type 1, even it is not mentioned there, but it is fixed. Type 1 deficiency, it is mean quantitative disorder, and type 2 deficiency also, it is due to structurally abnormal and qualitatively abnormal production of qualitatively abnormal protein C. We have also must to know that most heritable protein C deficiency is due to type 1 deficiency. It is due to type 1 deficiency. Majority are due to point mutation. Another also important subject, and also we are still in the heritable thrombophilia, it is a protein S deficiency. Gene for protein S, it is located on the chromosome 3, vitamin K dependent glycoprotein. What is protein S? Also, it is a vitamin K dependent glycoprotein produced in the liver, endothelial cells, and megakaryocytes. it is a non-enzymatic cofactor for activated protein C-mediated inactivation. Also, we mentioned it previously, mechanism of its action. It is act as a cofactor, and then who supports the protein, activated protein C in its function that mediated an activation of factor 5, activated factor 5, and activated factor 8. Also, it is acting as a cofactor for tissue factor pathway inhibitor. Acting as a cofactor for tissue factor pathway inhibitor. What are the types of deficiency in protein C? S. Somewhat here it is different than antithrombin and protein S. Protein C deficiency. In antithrombin protein C, we mentioned that we have two types of deficiency: type 1, type 2. Type 1, it is a quantitative disorder, and type 2, it is a qualitative structure abnormality. Here we have three types of deficiency. In type 1 deficiency, both the total and the free protein S level are low. We are still so the reduction here also in the quantity can mean both total and free protein. We know that I think also you know it, that we have two types of protein S. I don't mention it because you are sure you take it in the lectures of hemostasis given to you, that protein S, we have two types. We have free type and we have total. So in type 1 deficiency, both the total and free protein S level should be low to say that it is a type 1 deficiency. While type 2 defects or and abnormality, it is characterized by reduced activity in the presence of normal total and free level. يعني تقريبا نفس الفكرة إنه type 1 هي quantitative, both total and free protein S level are low. المشكلة بالكمية. Type 2 المشكلة بالactivity. So it is activity and structural abnormality. So defect is also quantitative. Reduces activity in the presence of normal total and free protein S level. What about type 3 deficiency? In the type 3 deficiency, the total protein S level is normal, but the free protein S level is low. And then we have three types of deficiencies or defect in case of antithrombin. Protein S. Type 1, the problem, both total and free protein S level are low. Type 2, the problem, it is reduced activity in the presence of normal total. ما عندنا مشكلة بالamount. In the type 2 deficiency, both of them are normal, both total and free protein S are normal, only the activity have been reduced. While in type 3, the total level, it is normal. The total level is normal, only the free protein S is low. This is, we are also still in the inherited thrombophilia. Factor V leading, we speak about it previously, and I tell you that we will speak in details. Factor V leading, V means factor 5 leading gene mutation, which is so common and important entity in the project subject of thrombophilia. It is the most common inherited cause of an increased risk of venous thrombosis. It is occur in approximately 3 to 7% of factor 5 allele in white people. So it is common in white people more than black people. What is the problem? Why this type of mutation occur and how it is leading to thrombosis and increased tendency for venous thrombosis? How? There is failure of activated protein C to prolong the activated partial thromboblastin time test when added to plasma, and the phenotype is sometimes referred to as activated protein C resistance. The incidence of factor 5 leading in patients with venous thrombosis is approximately 20 to 40%. يعني نحاول نبسطها. يعني احنا من اسمها هي factor 5 leading gene mutation. وين المشكلة إذن؟ There will be mutation in the factor 5 gene, in the gene for factor 5. زين factor 5 احنا نعرف من اللي يثبط عمله هو activated protein C. قلنا حتى يشتغل كأنتيكوأجولانت راح will act and inactivate and inhibit the function and of factor 5 and فاكتور 8. زين من اني عندي هذه الميوتيشن this type of mutation نصح لها فاكتور 5 leading gene mutation there will be resistant to the function of activated protein C to inhibit. يعني احنا normally factor 5 will be inhibited by activated protein C. من عندنا هذه الميوتيشن الموجودة بالفاكتور 5 بالعامل الخامس ما راح يستجيب للانهيبيشن الموجود راح يبقى. لذلك احنا نقول activated protein C resistance المفروض هو normally normal factor 5 اللي ما بي mutation راح يستجيب للانهيبيشن للانكتيفيشن by the activated protein C. لكن هذه الميوتيشن no it will be resist to the inhibition and the inactivation by the activated protein C. فأني المفروض من أجيب بلازما شنو المفروض بها جميع عوامل التخثر من ضمنها factor 5 and factor 8 اللي يشتغل عليهم. احنا هسه في مجال التحدث فقط عن الفاكتور 5 لان باعتبار هذه الميوتيشن هي اوكر ان دي فاكتور 5. لذلك جبت بلازما على سبيل المثال اي بلازما بها عوامل التخثر نورمالي من اجيب اكتيفيتد بروتين سي واضيفه يعني عندي فد محضر اكتيفيتد بروتين سي ضفته ايش راح يصير عندي راح يصير اكيد راح يصير انهيبيشن للفاكتور 5 والفاكتور 8 بهالحاله البي تي تي اذا تتذكرون قلنا البي تي تي اللي هو يعني هو تيست على مود لتوضيح عمل وكفاءه الانترنسك باث واي اكيد ايش راح يصير بي برولونجيشن هذا النورمال المتوقع النورمال. لكن المريض اللي عنده فاكتور 5 ليدن جين ميوتيشن من اجيب البلازما تو ذا بيشنت فاكتور 5 ليدن When I put to it activated protein C, I see that there will be resistance. There will be no prolongation to the partial activated partial thromboblastin time. This will prove that this type of the mutation. This means that there will be a problem. Normally, there should be prolongation if the factor 5 has a normal structure. While if there is this mutation, there will be resistance to the activated protein C function and addition to the plasma so this will what we call it activated protein C resistance. طبعا as we mentioned that it is occur more in the white people it is more common inherited cause of increased risk of thrombosis it is occur in patients with venous thrombosis بنسبة تقريبا 20 to 40% which is a high persons. Another type of mutation also we still in the inherited or heritable thrombophilia is factor 2 gene factor 2 which is prothrombin gene at this site at the site of the amino acid sequence we call it 2210 A mutation يعني هذا اسم الميوتيشن مستوحى او مأخوذ من ال sequence of the amino acid through which the mutation occur it is occur at the amino acid sequence to 20210 A mutation. So the gene for prothrombin it is located on chromosome 2. Prothrombin it is a vitamin K dependent protein synthesized in the liver. As you know, a single how this mutation occur. It is a single nucleotide changes at position as we mentioned at position 20210 in the 3 prime untranslated region of the prothrombin gene. It is associated with elevated plasma prothrombin level and increased risk of venous thrombosis. يعني هذه الميوتيشن when it is occur at this sequence at the 3 prime untranslated region of the prothrombin gene at this amino acid sequence 20210 تحصيل حاصل راح تسوي لنا increase in prothrombotic activity and مو بس ال activity increase plasma level when this mutation occur and the prothrombin gene lead to increase plasma prothrombin level and increase activity so it is increased risk of venous thrombosis. قبل ما نعرج على هذا الموضوع الاكوارد هيموفيليا يعني بس اكيد يعني هسه احنا ما يعني ما دام عرفنا انه عندنا هذه اللي هي ماسكمان الفاكتور 5 ليدن والسكند كمان ان امبورتنت اللي هي فاكتور 2 جين ميوتيشن. اكيد يعني زي مثلا it is a gene mutation. So من ضمن التحاليل اللي مفروض تساعدني بالتشخيص اكيد جينيتك ستدي، يعني من اسالك هي ميوتيشن. هسه مثلا فاكتور 5 ليدن بالاضافه للاكتيفيتد بروتين سي ريسيستنس، اكيد انا احتاج جينيتك ستدي حتى اثبت وجود the mutation in the factor 5 gene. فانت اكيد راح تقول لي بالاضافه للاكتيفيتد بروتين سي ريسيستنس اللي هي هذه سبيسيفيك تيست لها، اكيد عندنا جينيتك اسي احتاجه بدون ما لذلك ما ذكرتها، المفروض انت يعني تلقائيا تعرفها. It is factor 5 leading gene mutation one of the tests. It is genetic assay I needed to confirm the presence of this mutation and this abnormality. Also factor 2, when I ask you how you confirm the diagnosis, you will tell me that genetic assay and DNA assay, it is important to prove that there is a mutation factor 2 gene at this amino acid sequence that I mentioned that lead to increased prothrombin level and so increased risk of venous thrombosis. Okay. Another important subject, we are still in the thrombophilia, it is acquired thrombophilia. احنا اخذنا هسه الانهيرتد وعرفنا من ضمن الانهيرتد قلنا بروتين انتثرومبين ديفيشنسي وبروتين سي ديفيشنسي اند بروتين اس ديفيشنسي. also we add take factor 5 leading which is the most common cause for inherited thrombophilia occur in white people occur in about persons patient venous thrombosis the rate of this or incidence of this mutation factor 5 حوالي 20 إلى 40%. الموضوع الثاني كان factor 2 mutation اللي هو prothrombin mutation اللي هي تصير at position amino acid sequence 20210A جين اللي تؤدينا إلى زيادة prothrombin level وبالتالي زيادة increased tendency for venous thrombosis. Acquired thrombophilia also it is an important subject. We have this table. I make 3 starting because it is so important for you to know. These are the causal factors in acquired venous thromboembolism. What are? It is either. Also, it is common. I think that all of you know it, but we have to mention it here. Inevitable environmental, like increasing the age, pregnancy, and postpartum. Immobility, like long travel. Dehydration, iatrogenic like post-operative and immobilization, indwelling venous devices, pharmacological, أحيانا drugs أيضا ممكن تسوينا اللي هي estrogens, chemotherapy, heparin, procoagulant treatment. طبعا الهيبارين هو anticoagulant لكن أيضا في بعض الأحيان ايضا هو ممكن يسبب لنا ترومبوفيليا. و also we will mention the subject اللي هو heparin induced thrombophilia sorry heparin induced thrombocytopenia. we'll take it in the last of this lecture and speak about it in details. Procoagulant treatment, disease related like antiphospholipid syndrome. in the cancer there is increased tendency for thrombosis. myeloproliferative diseases اكيد اللي هي ايضا انتم ماخذيها بمحاضرات سابقه مثل البوليسايثيميا رابرافيرا استنشال ثرومبوسايثيميا. all these also lead to increased tendency for thrombosis. acute promyelocytic leukemia inflammatory status and hematological diseases like PNH paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria اللي هي ايضا احنا اعتقد يعني تحدثنا عنها في مواضيع سابقه. PNH it is form of acquired hemolytic anemia. المشكلة تصير هي in the protein that's responsible for the stability of the red cell membrane. there will be deficiency or reduction in the CD55. CD means cluster of differentiation. these are responsible for the stability of the protein glycosyl phosphatidyl inositol. when these deficiencies there is a problem in the stability and structure of this protein that give the integrity and stability of red cell membrane. so this will causing this type of the hemolytic anemia. one of the clinical feature of this anemia it is thrombosis. but in addition to hemolysis it is acquired hemolytic anemia. so the patient will present it with hemolysis and thrombosis and renal problem. one of the feature of paroxysmal nocturnal clinical feature of paroxysmal nocturnal hemo it's thrombosis. TTB sickle cell disease also there is increased tendency for thrombosis and also intravenous drug abuse. One of the important entities in the acquired thrombophilia is antiphospholipid syndrome. Antiphospholipid syndrome, it is so common in our society, especially in the pregnant ladies. It is let define and know some details about it. It is a syndrome of positive antiphospholipid antibody. Positive antiphospholipid antibody with a feature of thrombosis or pregnancy complication. من التعريف معناها انه انا لازم عندي متوفرة clinical feature of thrombosis or pregnancy complication in addition to positive antiphospholipid antibody. يعني احتاج laboratory feature بالاضافة للclinical feature حتى اقول او حتى تتحقق عندي المتطلبات لتشخيص الانتيفوسفوليبيد سيندروم. So what are the diagnostic criteria? It is include clinical criteria as we mentioned. So we need a clinical and we need lab test for detection of antiphospholipid syndrome. Clinical criteria is thrombosis, either arterial or venous in any parts. Pregnancy complication like unexplained intrauterine death, recurrent abortion, premature birth. Laboratory tests include antiphospholipid antibody detection like lupus anticoagulant. طبعا lupus anticoagulant بالاضافه نحن نعرف هي موجوده بالاس ال اي لكن ايضا توافرها يعني ايضا تعتبر من ضمن الانتيفوسفوليبيد انتيبادي that could be seen and detected in a patient with antiphospholipid syndrome which was initially detected in patient with SLE as we mentioned systemic lupus erythematosus and is identified by prolonged activated prothrombin time, plasma activated APTT, which does not correct with 50-50 mixture of normal plasma. أعتقد إحنا شارحيها قبل الميكسينج ستدي. الميكسينج ستدي شرحناها بموضوع الكوغوليشن وأخذناها باللاب لكن نعرج عليها فد ملاحظات بسيطة إنه when a patient present to me with prolonged activated partial thromboblastin time, as we know, APTT, which is, as we mentioned, it is a test to detect function وكفاءة the intrinsic pathway. So when patient present to me with prolonged APTT, أكيد أنا راح أما factor deficiency كنا أو ممكن يكون inhibitor. لذلك أنا حتى أميز بيناتهم I will do mixing study I will bring equal volume equal concentration of the patient plasma that I want to test it the patient that have prolonged APTT plasma take plasma from a patient with prolonged APTT and the same concentration of plasma of normal individual أخذ كميات متساوية أحجام متساوية خذت 1 مل من المريض المعني اللي عنده برولونج اي بي تي تي واخذت مثلا 1 مل من بلازما متاكده منها طبيعيه اللي هي الكنترول سويت له ميكسينج ميكستشر زين راح ارجع اعيد للاي بي تي تي كانما من البدايه اخذ اطبق اسوي تيست للاي بي تي تي من الميكستشر اخذ واجي اشوف اذا بقى برولونج بدون ما تعدل معناته شنو هذه معناته انهبيتر اذا لا تعدل معناته المشكله انه عنده فاكتور ديفيشنسي ومن ضفت البلازما الحاويه على الفاكتور الناقص اكيد عدلته يعني فمعناته انه هو فاكتور ديفيشنسي اعيد مره ثانيه انا عندي مريض برولونج اي بي تي تي هاز برولونج اي بي تي تي اللي هي قلنا تيست تو تيست اند ديتكت ذا functions of the intrinsic pathway فاني اجيب اسوي ميكسينج ستدي اللي هي 50 50 50 50 يعني يقصد 50 50 معناته احجام متساويه من البلازما للمريض اللي عنده برولونج اي بي تي تي ومن البلازما الكنترول الطبيعيه سويت ميكسينج ومن هذا الميكستشر رجعت عدت الاي بي تي تي سويته مره ثانيه لو كان المريض عنده الخلل نقص فاكتور اكيد هذا النقص فاكتور من البلازما الطبيعيه تعدل فالمفروض اتوقع الاي بي تي تي راح يتعدل عندي حتى اذا ما وصل للطبيعي المهم مثلا الاي بي تي تي 50 لو كان نقص فاكتر خلينا نقول صار نقول مثلا 40 يعني مهم اكو يعني احس اكو استجابه تعدل الاي بي تي قل عن القيمه العاليه الاوليه اللي كانت عندي. لكن اذا بقى مثلا لا بقى عدت مرتين ثانيه بقى 50 معناته انه موجود عنده انهبيتر the problem not in the factor deficiency but there is antibodies causing the prolongation of the activated partial thromboplastin time. هذا هو الطريقه اللي اني how to test the inhibitors. One of them it is lupus anticoagulants. What is the second test? A second test dependent on limiting quantity of phospholipids such as the dilute resolved fiber venom test also used in diagnosis. احنا قلنا الانتيفوسفوليبيد سيندروم تحتاج clinical criteria اللي هي pregnancy complication or thrombosis in venous site حتى اقول عليها انتيفوسفوليبيد بالاضافة للاب تيست. اللاب تيست هي لازم احتاج checking and detect the presence of antiphospholipid antibody اللي من ضمنهم قلنا lupus anticoagulant. lupus anticoagulant قلنا التيست لها هو mixing study عادة هو المتبع اسويه. اذا ما صار correction من اضيف النورمال بلازما معناته اكو inhibitor. من ضمن التحاليل ايضا هي نصح له dilute resolved fiber venom test. dilute resolved fiber venom test يعني أنا ما أريد تعرف البروسيجر بس مجرد اسم التحليل هذا. الفكرة أنه هو من اسمه فايبر فينوم أكو نوع من أنواع الأفاعي شافوا أنه خلال التيست أنه نسبة الفوسفوليبيد بها عالية لذلك on dilutions بالمختبر نسوي multiple dilutions of this venom لهذا النوع من السم أكيد لانه بنسبه فوسفوليبيد عاليه وهي من اسمها انتي فوسفوليبيد انتيبودي. نضيف البيشنت بلازما لو كانت موجوده الانتيبودي راح يصير كوجوليشن فمعناته شنو؟ معناته اذا موجوده الانتي فوسفوليبيد انتيبودي انا ما اريدك تعرف البروسيجر just the name of the test just I want you to know that such a test also can be used to detect for anti phospholipid syndrome and detect the presence of antiphospholipid antibody. Whereas lupus anticoagulant are reactive in the fluid phase, other antiphospholipid antibodies such as anticardiolipin antibody and antibody to beta 2 glycoprotein 1 are identified by solid phase immune assay. Then معناته التست we have a solid phase assay and we have a fluid assay. Fluid assay احنا حكينا عن اللي هو الـ test for detection lupus anticoagulant through mixing study سميناه fluidic assay. Solid phase assay عادة immune assay يعني ELISA solid phase assay immune assay عادة هي ELISA المتبعة to detect these anticardiolipin antibodies. Both solid assay and coagulation test for lupus anticoagulant should be used in the diagnosis of antiphospholipid. So both solid phase and coagulation test for lupus anticoagulant should be used in the diagnosis of antiphospholipid syndrome. So diagnosis require one clinical and one lab criteria. طبعا types of antiphospholipid it is either primary with no evidence of another conditions or secondary with other disease such as connective tissue disease, lymphoproliferative disease, post viral infection, certain drugs. موضوع مهم ايضا جدا and it's common in general it is so common to see it in clinical issue and clinical practices it is a deep venous thrombosis clinical suspicion DVT is suspected in patients with a painful swollen lip. It is more common in those with previous deep venous thrombosis or a superficial venous thrombosis or cancer in the leg, unilateral thigh or calf swelling or tenderness, beating edema and the presence of collateral superficial non-varicose pain are important signs. Homan sign, pain in the calf on flexing flexing the ankle, it is unreliable. يعني DVT مو يعني اتوقع موضوع مر عليكم سامعين بيه. عادة احنا يجينا المريض first of all قبل laboratory test عندي لازم clinical suspicion قبل ما يعني اخلي ببالي المريض يجيني للطوارئ او anywhere. has a unilateral, غالبا unilateral ممكن bilateral, لكن غالبا السيناريو القصة للمريض هي unilateral leg swelling, hotness, pain, unilateral. Then as we mentioned here, unilateral thigh or calf swelling or tenderness, beating edema and the presence of collateral superficial non-varicose vein. Then these are important signs to put in mind that patient may have deep VT. طبعا اكيد الهيستوري مثلا patient عنده previous DVT, ممكن اذا اساله بالهيستوري, او ممكن عنده cancer. These are, يعني I have in the history to dig on them because I have to check if there is any risk factor for development of whether patient bedridden. As we mentioned previously, the risk factor for اكيد immobilization, old age, cigarette smoking, مثلا previous surgery, recent surgery or myeloproliferative, مثلا ممكن عنده ورأسا فجأة صار عنده ايضا هذا risk factor. So I have to a chronic disease, as we mentioned cancer, all these are risk factor. بالإضافة للclinical feature, I have to ask about history of aggravating factor or risk factor for the development of deep venous thrombosis. What I send the patients, if I put in my mind that the patient may have deep venous thrombosis, DVT, I do plasma D-dimer concentration. What is the D-dimer? طبعا concentration of these, it is a fibrin breakdown product. D-dimer, it is a fibrin breakdown product. It is raised when there is a fresh thrombosis. We have what we call it was the score. Here I will, we have no time to mention it. I think that should be mentioned in the clinical lecture. عادة للكلينيشن بالإضافة للدي دايمر, we have what we call it Wells score. يعني أكو فد كرايتيريا معينة الطبيب الباطني يعتمدها, Wells score, مثلا chest X-ray finding, echo finding, يخليها بباله. إذا جمعت الكرايتيريا نقاط معينة, معناته هذا أكيد المريض مثلا خلينا نقول عنده دي بي تي, زين عنده فد كرايتيريا نصح له Wells scores. These are clinician usually it is depend on them in the diagnosis of the DVT. Depend in addition to the D-dimer concentration, he will put in mind how the severity and the DVT was reached, and also depend on it in the giving the treatment, starting the treatment. So the Wells score and also D-dimer can be used to predict the chance of thrombosis. A negative results in emergency departments can be used to exclude DVT or pulmonary embolism and avoid the need for radiological imaging. يعني إجاني المريض مثلا ما حصل الكرايتيريا and the Wells score, يعني انه ممكن المريض Wells score كان negative. Wells score كان negative. لذلك عادة الكلينيشن will exclude that the patient has a DVT or pulmonary embolism, حتى ما يحتاج انه يدز فور radiological imaging. With first suspicion of DVT in the legs and other sites, it can be combined with Doppler, Doppler scanning, which improve accuracy by focusing on the individual vein. اذا بالاضافه للدي دايمر, بالاضافه للولز سكور اللي يعتمد عليها ايضا لتشخيص, عندنا radiological imaging من ضمنها Doppler ايضا so important, and it is improve accuracy by focusing on the individual vein. بعد شنو من ضمن الامور اللي احتاجها لتشخيص الدي بي تي هي كونتراست بينو. كونتراست يعني معناها اني داي, the doctor will insert a dye, will insert a dye and then under visualization. طبعا هو this test is now rarely performed. Iodinated contrast medium is injected into the vein peripheral to the suspected DVT. This permit direct demonstration by X-ray. إذن أنا عندي dye, inject dye peripheral to the site of suspected area that has DVT, and then under the imaging I have to visualize. عادة المنطقة اللي بيها obstruction راح نشوف الداي موجودة peripheral إلها, ما راح يوصل لأن أكو obstruction. منطقة اللي بيها obstruction الداي ما راح تفوت لها, فمعناها أعرف إنه أكو فد thrombus occlude the veins, and that's why prevent the passage and visualization of this dye by the X-ray. What else? It is a magnetic resonance imaging. This may also be used, but it is expensive. It is indicated when ultrasound might be inaccurate or difficult, such as because of the obesity or patient with a blaster cast. BOB cast, يعني patient عنده fracture مثلا ومضطرين يسوي له بلاستر كاست وما اقدر يعني استعمل another way. That's why I have to do magnetic resonance imaging, but it is so expensive and done only in specific situation, as we mentioned, when ultrasound it is inaccurate or difficult, such as in obesity or patient with BOB cast. What else? We have also another entity in the acquired thrombosis or acquired thrombophilia. It is pulmonary embolism. Pulmonary embolus. عادة it is presence with shortness of breath. Yes, it is suspected that patient with pulmonary embolism, أكيد it is will present with respiratory symptom, shortness of breath. There may be pleuritic chest pain. So shortness of breath, chest pain. It is should be suspected in patient with signs or previous history of DVT, immobilization for more than 2 days or recent less than 4 weeks, surgery, hemoptysis or cancer. Then patient جاني sudden onset has shortness of breath, has a pleuritic chest pain, عنده previous history of DVT, has immobilization مثلا due to أما هو bedridden, old age, or مثلا has a surgery, recent surgery, and lead him to immobilize for more than 2 days or recently less than 4 weeks. And together with this has a hemoptysis, also has a history of cancer, تقريبا يعني نفس ال aggravating factor or the history of the patient of DVT اللي هي قلنا immobilization مثلا عنده recent surgery or even has a history of diseases that chronic disease such as a cancer that lead to increase the tendency for thrombosis. Recurrent pulmonary embolism may lead to pulmonary hypertension. What we need? Chest x-ray. It is often normal but may show evidence of pulmonary infarction or pleural fusion. اذا chest x-ray عادة normal لكن احتاجه احيانا اذا مخلي ببالي انه المريض ممكن عنده pulmonary infarction or pleural fusion. Electrocardiogram ECG. This is performed to determine whether there is right heart strain, which occurs only in relatively severe cases. If there is ECG, عادة أيضا أسوي if there is suspicion of right heart strain which occur only in relatively severe cases. What else? Also D-dimer. D-dimer, as we mentioned previously, it has become elevated and beneficial in fresh thrombosis. Ventilation perfusion, scintigraphy. This detects areas of the lung being ventilated but not perfused. So what we see in the ventilation perfusion scintigraphy, we'll see that there will be ventilation perfusion mismatch. Ventilation perfusion mismatch, يعني area detected, it is ventilated but not perfused. Ventilated but not perfused. Computed tomography, pulmonary angiography, هو اسمه. Computed tomography, pulmonary angiography. Just, I want for you just enumeration only. Magnetic resonance pulmonary angiography. Pulmonary angiography, it is the traditional reference method, but it is invasive with complication. It is invasive with complications. Investigations for the thrombophilia. Here it is in general, if a patient come to me with a thrombophilia, what I should do to him? How can I reach to the diagnosis in order to start the treatment? Tests that may be abnormal in patients with a tendency to venous thrombosis include, first of all, we will start usually with the blood count, CBC and ESR. Why? To detect if there is any elevation in the hematocrit, white blood cell count and platelet count. Even sometimes from the ESR, it can be high in case of if there is elevation in the fibrinogen and globulin. إذن blood count يعطيني فكرة إذا أكو patients such as in the myeloproliferative disease, we see that there will be high RBC count, high hematocrit, sometimes in the in case of essential thrombocythemia, platelet become so high. This so it can give me the blood count can give me some idea about the condition or underlying illness or risk factor for the patient with thrombophilia. Blood film, it is so important. Sometimes it is provide evidence of myeloproliferative disorder. Also from the blood film I can see what's happened and underlying illness for the patient. Leukoerythroblastic feature. Leukoerythroblastic feature means I see erythroid immature precursor and granulocytic myeloid, white BC immature precursor such as myelocyte pro, myelocyte, metamyelocyte and so on. These indicate malignant disease. That patient, when I see leukoerythroblastic picture, means sometimes the patient may have malignant condition. Thus, I can reach the underlying illness and risk factor for his increased thrombotic tendency. What else? Also, prothrombin time and activated partial thromboblastin time. You remember that we use these in patient with the bleeding. We see that there will be prolongation either in PT and PTT according to the deficiency factor. Here also we can use it, but instead of a prolongation there will be shortening axillary bleeding. In the bleeding there will be prolongation in the APTT or PT. Here there will be shortening in there is a thrombophilia or there is increment in the factor. So shorting activated partial thromboblastin time is often seen in thrombotic state and may indicate the presence of activated clotting factor. يعني زيادة مثلا factor, if some patient has inherited increment in factor 9 or 8, we'll see that there will be prolongation of, shortening of the ABTT. Here we mention it, a prolonged ABTT test not corrected by the addition of normal plasma suggests a lupus, as we mentioned previously. Lupus APTT not corrected by the addition of normal plasma suggests there will be lupus anticoagulant or acquired inhibitor to coagulation factor. What else? We have also anticardiolipin and beta 2 glycoprotein I antibody. These are mentioned previously in the antiphospholipid syndrome. Thrombin time and reptilase time prolongation suggest an abnormal fibrinogen. Thrombin time, we mentioned it in the hemostasis lecture. We see that it is an important test to detect to seek for the function and amount of fibrinogen. If it is prolonged, it is either deficiency in the fibrinogen or abnormal dysfibrinogenemia. There will be dysfibrinogenemia. Dysfibrinogenemia ممكن احنا نذكرت ايضا عندنا بالبليدنج. Dysfibrinogenemia تحتمل احتمال يعني the patient with dysfibrinogenemia either presented with bleeding or could be presented also with thrombosis because it is a dysfunctioning. So thrombin time and reptilase time, it is I suggest that there will be sometimes maybe abnormal fibrinogen. This fibrinogen assay also it is needed to see if there is hyperfibrinogenemia. DNA analysis for factor V leading, as we mentioned previously. إذن هذه thrombophilia test هسه احنا بدنا نحكي عنها in general, بدنا نحكي يعني مو اي مريض اني عندي احكي لك التيست اللي راح اعتمدهم في واللي اتوقع انه ممكن اشوفهم abnormality accordingly. هسه مثلا DNA analysis in factor V leading, antithrombin in case of antithrombin deficiency ايش راح احتاج؟ يحتاج immunological and functional assay to detect and reach the diagnosis of antithrombin deficiency. Protein C and protein S immunological and functional assays. Prothrombin gene analysis for the G20210A variant mutation. Plasma homocysteine estimation اللي قلنا بحالة الهايبر هوموسيستينيميا أيضا. Test for CD59. CD means cluster of differentiation. Cluster of differentiation 59 and cluster of differentiation 55. Expression array cell if in case of BNH حكيناها. If it is suspected, I do So these tests, it is accordingly. It is according to what I put in mind. Test for JAK2 V617F mutation. شو وقت أسويها إذا مثلاً أنا عندي patient suspected myeloproliferative. سويت له CBC وطلع عندي PCV عالي, RBC count عالي مثلاً, وخليت ببالي إنه المريض ممكن عنده polycythemia أو ممكن إحنا قلنا JAK2 V617F mutation. This is important and it is pathognomonic and specific to diagnose myeloproliferative. This high percent, it is appear in high percent, about 95% to 98% in a patient with polycythemia, but seen in lower percent with a patient with myelofibrosis and essential thrombocythemia. Then he ممكن تكون positive. لذلك إذا عندي الفيلم أو CBC هو suggestive for myeloproliferative, أني إن من أحول JAK2 V617F mutation to prove my thinking and my idea about the myeloproliferative. If I put it in mind from the CBC and film, so I have to do JAK2 V617F mutation, especially if a patient has a portal or hepatic vein thrombosis. Added in case of JAK2 mutation positive, highly usual patient present with portal or hepatic vein thrombosis. Protein electrophoresis in case for paraproteinemia, case of paraproteinemia, which is also providing a risk factor, and patient presented with venous thrombosis. Now, an also important subject, I put on it three starring also. It is so important subject for you to know. Thrombosis treatment and lab control of them. Thrombosis treatment and laboratory control for them. فقط التريتمنت احنا راح نحكي اهم شيء عندنا بصوره عامه. انتي كوغولانت دراج ار يوز وايدلي ان ذا تريتمنت اوف فينوس ثرومبو امبوليك ديزيز. ذير فاليو ان ذا تريتمنت اوف ارتيريال ثرومبوسيس از ليس ويل استابليش. منو عندنا الهيبارين اكثر شيء. الهيبارين طبعا ات از سو كومن تو بي يوز از انتي كوغولانت دراجز. ات از اسيديك طبعا. هو it is two type. We have low molecular weight heparin and we have unfractionated heparin. Let's speak about the first type. Unfractionated heparin, طبعا this acidic unfractionated mucopolysaccharide of average molecular weight 15,000 إلى 18,000. It is an inhibitor of blood coagulation. شون هو ليش how it is act as an anticoagulant? Because of its action in the potentiating the activity of antithrombin. Then who act as anticoagulant because it is potentiated and increase the activity of the antithrombin, which is an natural anticoagulant. It is not absorbed from the GIT, must be given by injection. It is inactivated by the liver and excreted in the urine. Inactivated by the liver and excreted by the urine. Standard unfractionated heparin, it is, as we mentioned, it is given by intravenous infusion. بينما low molecular weight heparin عادة way for given it is by subcutaneous injection. So unfractionated heparin given intravenously, while low molecular weight heparin, as we will mention later on, is given by subcutaneous injection. It is used عادة, it is treatment of choice where rapid reversal of anticoagulation by protamine sulfate may be required. Example in surgical patient or late pregnancy. يعني شو وقت استعمله من اني محتاجه اصلا for low period, ما احتاجه for long period. يعني احتاجه rapid reversal. احنا يعني المتعارف عليه انه inhibition, حتى شو نقول inhibition of the function of the heparin, او اقلل فتره عمله. احتاج انطي للمريض المثبط مالته اللي هو بروتامين سلفيت. بروتامين سلفيت يضبط عمل الهيبارين, يوقف عمله ويسوي له rapid reversal to its function as anticoagulant. لذلك من عندي rapid reversal, أحتاج rapid reversal for its function by protamine sulfate, أني أنطي unfractionated heparin. شو وقت أحتاجه in surgical patient or in late pregnancy. In surgical patients or يعني فترة السيرجري قصيرة مثلا 3 ساعات 4 ساعات, والمريض اعطيته هيبارين لانه مثلا هو بيدردن او عنده فدرس فاكتور, for thrombosis, أو هو أصلا يعني هو non case of يعني has a thrombus. زين واحتاجت أنطي هيبارين، لكن نفس الوقت فترة العملية قصيرة قد تكون 3 ساعات أو حسب يعني. المهم أحتاج rapid reversal، ما أحتاج فترة طويلة إنه يكون ال action of هيبارين. لذلك أنطي in case of surgery and case of late pregnancy. How we can monitor, how laboratory monitoring for and fractionated heparin, عادة by maintaining the APTT at 1.5 to 2.5 times the upper limit of normal value. يعني انت هذا ما مطلوب منك، يعني بس مجرد اريدك تعرف انه اني اسوي monitoring للان fractionated heparin by checking the APTT by maintaining the APTT at 1.5 إلى 2.5 times of the upper limit of normal. Unfractionated heparin is better monitored by NT10 assay. هذا specific assay, we do it in the lab. Usually it is more specific than the APTT, but first usually we start by APTT, activated partial thromboblastin time, as lab monitoring for unfractionated heparin. Another type of monitoring is by NT factor 10 assay, where this is available as more reliable method than APTT for this person, for this purpose. Then أريدك تخلي we have to put in mind that any fractionated heparin, how can be laboratory monitoring, how we can monitor its function in the lab by APTT, activated partial thromboblastin time, and second by NT factor 10 assay, which is more reliable when it is present. It's more reliable method than APTT for this purpose. Okay. Second, we have low molecular weight heparin preparation. It is about molecular weight 2000 إلى 10000, have a greater ability to inhibit factor 10 than to inhibit thrombin and interact less with platelet than standard heparin, and so may have lesser tendency to cause bleeding. It's interact less with platelet. Mechanism of action is inhibit factor 10 than to inhibit thrombin. So, low molecular weight heparin, it is has a more predictable dose response which avoid the need for routine monitoring. يعني من أسألك how we can laboratory monitoring for low molecular weight heparin. راح تقول لي it has a more predictable dose response, so it need no monitoring. عادة low molecular weight heparin ما يحتاج monitoring because it has a predictable dose response. شو وقت أسوي له laboratory monitoring? Although routine monitoring it is not required, measurement of NT factor 10 assay peak level 4 hours after injection allow dose adjustment in selected. إذن أسوي له laboratory monitoring 4 hours after injection in special situation where pregnancy, renal failure, gross obesity and in children. Laboratory monitoring للأنفراكشنيتد هيبارين by APTT and by antifactor 10 assay, which is more reliable. Low molecular weight heparin need no monitoring because it has more predictable dose response. But in special situation we can do monitoring 4 hours after injection in special situation, again pregnancy, renal failure, gross obesity and in children. Low molecular weight heparin, it is treatment of choice for DVT, pulmonary embolism and unstable angina. Patients with uncomplicated DVT are now managed initially with regular low molecular weight heparin injection, even at home, once or twice daily according to the preparation. أكيد إذن هو it is more يعني because it is not cause bleeding, so it is more preferable use in treatment for DVT, pulmonary embolism, unstable angina. It is also the preferred treatment of DVT in cancer patients, pregnancy, because it does not cross the placenta. Low molecular weight heparin used for prevention, and then هو not only treatment. إحنا قلنا treatment of DVT, pulmonary embolism, unstable angina. أحياناً أحتاجه حتى prophylactic prevention of DVT in both medical and surgical patient. Patient مثلاً أتوقع إنه ممكن يصير old patient وbedridden وهذا مثلاً فد fracture وهذا ال fracture تأخذ له فترة طويلة وأتوقع ممكن إنه يصير عنده thrombosis. لذلك ممكن أنطي it is so safe as prophylactic treatment and act as to prevention DVT in both medical and surgical patients. Question. Mention briefly a few points as a comparison between low molecular weight heparin and unfractionated heparin. من الكلام اللي السابق تحدثنا عنه بالمحاضرة, I wish that you put in your mind how you can differentiate and compare between low molecular weight heparin and unfractionated heparin in a few notes. We have also an important subject regarding thrombophilia, it is heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. Heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, which we mention it as a cause for thrombosis. From its name, one can put or think that heparin-induced thrombocytopenia means bleeding. No, it means there will be thrombosis. Let's speak about it. There will be mild lowering of platelet count may occur in the first 24 hours as a result of platelet clumping. Mild lowering of platelet count occur in the first 24 hours of using heparin. It is occur as a result of platelet clumping. This is of no clinical consequences. Heparin induced thrombocytopenia type 1. We have type 1. Heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, this of no clinical sequence. ما تهمنا, ما بيها أي سيكولي, ما بيها, it is, can be improved easily, so not cause a problem. اللي تهمنا هي type 2, the important, it is heparin-induced thrombocytopenia type 2, which is occurring up to 5% of the patients who are treated with unfractionated heparin. إذن, إحنا عندنا heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, mild lowering of platelet نتيجة platelet clumping. الميكانيزم هسه راح نحكي عنها هو انه antibody راح تصير immune complex تؤدينا الى زيادة ترابط الهيباري مع platelet factor 4 نتيجة IgG antibody. هذا اللي راح يؤدينا الى زيادة function of platelet, زيادة activation of platelet, وبنفس الوقت راح يؤدينا الى من راح يصير اكتيفيشن, راح يصير كلامبينج. هي قلت صحيح لكن زادت الاكتيفيتي مالتها فسوت لنا ثرومبوسيس. صحيح صار عندي اميون كومبلكس, هذا الاميون كومبلكس ادى الى ترابط الهيبارين مع بليتليت فاكتور 4. هذا بوجود الاي جي جي انتي بودي ادانا الى مور اكتيفيتي, مور اكتيفيشن تو ذا بليتليت, سو ات از بيكم مور اكتيف ليدنج تو اجريجيت. When they become activated and aggregate, form thrombus, despite their lowering of number, due to these immune complexes, it is cause thrombosis. اللي يهمنا, type 1, it is not important. It is of no clinical consequences. The most important, it is type 2. This occur in 5% of patients who are treated with unfractionated heparin. With any fractionated heparin, not with low molecular weight heparin, put in mind, with any fractionated heparin, and paradoxically present with thrombosis. It is result, as we mentioned, from binding of heparin to platelet factor 4, followed by the generation of IgG antibody to the heparin platelet factor complex, which lead to platelet activation, thrombocytopenia, and thrombosis. And then سبب thrombosis or platelet activation to become aggregate with each other. Due to these also immune complexes increase their activity, and despite the thrombocytopenia there will be increased tendency for thrombosis. It is present as a fall of more than 50% platelet count 5 or more days after starting heparin treatment, or earlier if heparin has been given previously. Diagnosis, it is difficult, but assay have recently been developed to allow the detection of antibody to immobilize heparin platelet factor 4 complex. Then again, heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. It is two types. Type 1, it is of no clinical consequences, not important, can be not causing problem, and can be easily to be gone and resolved and relieved. The type 2, it is so important. This will cause a problem. This will cause this occur about 5% of patients who are treated with unfractionated heparin. and it is result from the binding of the heparin to platelet factor 4 and then generation of IgG antibody causing immune complex. This immune complex lead to the platelet activation and thrombocytopenia and then thrombosis. It is associated with a fall of about 50% of the platelet count 5 days or more after starting the treatment of heparin. Could be earlier if heparin has been given previously. Diagnosis, it is difficult, but nowadays it's safe to detect antibody against this immobilized heparin platelet factor 4 complex. Another important subject, it is oral anticoagulant. It is oral anticoagulant. Until recently, the only available drugs has been derivative of coumarin or finindione. طبعا عندنا الوارفارين اللي هو coumarin. It is most widely used oral anticoagulant. It is vitamin K antagonist. من اسمه vitamin K antagonist. So treatment result in decrease the biological activity of vitamin K dependent factor اللي إذا تذكرون 1972 قلناها 2, 7, 9, 10. إذن الوارفارين اللي هو most common and most widely used oral anticoagulant. It is vitamin K antagonist. لذلك من اسمه vitamin K antagonist. إذن its function result in decrease the biological activity of vitamin K dependent factors اللي هي 1972. We have what we call it international normalized ratio. This is a form of lab monitoring for warfarin. How we can laboratory do monitoring of heparin in the laboratory, of warfarin in the laboratory. We can monitor warfarin treatment in the lab by doing INR, international normalized ratio. How? The effect of oral anticoagulant is monitored by PT and INR. When I ask you how can you monitor warfarin in the lab, you tell me by doing PT, prothrombin time, and by doing INR, international normalized ratio. What is, or how it is calculated? It is calculated from the PT itself. It is based on the ratio of the patient prothrombin time, PT, to a mean normal PT with correction for the sensitivity of thromboblastin use. It is calibrated against a primary WHO standard thromboblastin. Warfarin crosses the placenta and is teratogenic, so it is avoided in pregnancy. يعني هذه المعادلة سنجي عليها الـ INR نحسبها هي الـ PT patient على الـ general mean normal PT. General mean normal PT between brackets مرفوعة للأس International Sensitivity Index. هذا الحكي هذا الكلام كله هسه الحكينات توضيح مالته انه الـ INR هي PT patient to the total patient normal PT to the normal PT of the patient that يعني PT of the patient to the general mean normal PT مرفوع للأس International Sensitivity Index. هذا اللي حشيناه قلنا calibrated thromboblastin. هذه يعني حسب الـ WHO أنا هذه القيمة مالتها عندي ثابتة. حسب الثرومبوبلاستين اللي استعملته الشركة كل ثرومبوبلاستين أني أستعمله إلى International Sensitivity Index محسوبة حسب الـ WHO حسب يعني calibrated حسب الـ WHO حسب الـ type of thromboblastin that have been used. لذلك هذه fixed أني أنطيك إياها تجي ثابتة ويل according to the thromboblastin that have been used حسب الشركة من فلان شركة الـ ISI إلى كذا من فلان شركة وهكذا. إذن من أقول لك احسب لي الـ INR هي PT of the patient للمين normal والـ ISI أيضا أنا مطيتك إياها. إذن PT على المين PT normal مرفوعة للأس ISI so I can get the INR International Normalized Ratio. هسه احنا عرفنا بس مراجعة سريعة how we can laboratory how can we monitor the anticoagulant treatments in the laboratory. We have low molecular weight heparin, we have unfractionated heparin. لو قلنا molecular weight heparin, it is no need for monitoring, only in special situations. Sometimes I do anti-factor 10 assay in children, in the obese patient, in the pregnancy, in case of renal failure. Unfractionated heparin, usually we monitor it by APTT first, must reliable method, it is by anti-factor 10 assay if it is present. So, warfarin, how we monitor it in the laboratory? We monitor it by doing PTI and by INR, international normalizer ratio, which is calculated by this, بهذه المعادلة. PT patient على المين normal مرفوعة, all مرفوعة الوز ISI, international sensitivity index اللي هو محسوب حسب ال WHO and calibrated according to the thromboblastin that have been used. And thank you. أي سؤال إن شاء الله يعني حاضرين الإجابة عنه. أتمنى تكون المحاضرة وافية لكم وواضحة. أي سؤال إن شاء الله at any time. And wishing to you all the best. Thank you so much.